Hello friends, I am Neeru and today we are going to do SSC CGL Tier 1 paper. The paper is according to the new pattern which has been given by SSC and this is going to be paper code 857. I will give you detailed explanations for each and every question and we are going to do the general awareness section. General awareness is going to be very crucial in the new pattern because now time will not be an issue. And most of the students, they are comfortable with maths, everybody is comfortable in reasoning and more than half of the students are even comfortable in English. GA is the weak point of most of the students. 90% of the students are weak in GA and it is going to play a very crucial role in clearing the exam in the new pattern. So I'm going to do the GA section with you and I'm going to do the general awareness section from question number 26 to question number 50. Question number 26 to question number 50, paper code 857 is going to be discussed now in detail. Let's begin. The first one, question number 26. English education was introduced in India by, my options are Lord Curzon, Jawaharlal Nehru, then we have Lord Macaulay and Lord Dalhousie. These are my four options. These are my four options. My answer is C, Lord Macaulay. And this is a picture of Lord Macaulay. Let me tell you a little in about the background. It was in 1813 that it was decided that 1 lakh rupees would be spent on the education of Indians. There was a Charter Act of 1813 and in this act it was laid down that if British are collecting the revenue, they might as well be responsible for the education of the Indians and 1 lakh rupees was to be spent annually. It was to be spent annually. But then it was realized in the year 1823 that this money is not being spent on the education of Indians. And when it was asked why is the money not being spent on the education of Indians, the simple reply of the British government was that in India was that we do not know what to teach them. Should we teach them the traditional subjects that they have been studying or should we teach them the modern subjects? Should we teach them science? Should we teach them technology? What is to be taught? Should we teach them as per the modern times, the way world is studying? Or we are supposed to teach them in the traditional way in which they have been studying? This was the big question which was asked. Now to sort out this problem, Lord Macaulay was given the responsibility and a Macaulay committee was set up and they had to decide whether the Indians have to be taught in the traditional way. In the traditional way, that means in the oriental way, the way they had already been studying, or the modern method. The modern method known as the Anglican method of the Britishers, are they to be taught that way? In the modern method, they would be taught English, they would be taught science, and English would be the medium. Finally, when the decision was to be taken in the committee, there was a deadlock. There was a deadlock. Half the members said they should be taught in the traditional way in which they have been studying for centuries, and half the other members said no, let's go for modern education. Let's bring India at par with the world. Otherwise, they're going to lag behind. And then it was Lord Macaulay who had to decide. He had to cast the final vote. And he finally put the debate to an end by saying and stating that no, India is going to adopt the modern method of studying and I'm going to go in favor of English language. So this system of education was introduced by Lord Macaulay, and this is Macaulay's system of education. It was introduced in 1835. At that time, it was introduced in 1835 and this put the Anglicans and Orientalist debate to an end. And this system is also known as Lord Macaulay's Minutes. So very important, it was from then that English became a part of our system. English became a part of our system. And there was one more thing which is important with reference to Lord Macaulay's Minutes. He said that we do not have to educate the masses. The masses needn't be educated because 1 lakh rupees is quite a small amount to be spent on such a huge population. We have to educate a handful and then they will educate people under them. So it was the downward filtration theory which was introduced. The downward filtration theory. Very important in the history of education in India, because it was this act of Lord Macaulay, which finally decided that India is going to adopt English as the medium of instruction. Extremely important, and this also later proved to be beneficial because now finally for the clerical level jobs in India, finally the Britishers were able to get Indians who knew English language. Question number 26, my answer is going to be Lord Macaulay. Lord Dalhousie, Lord Dalhousie's period in India is from around 1848, around this period he came, and then he was here till 1856. This was his period, and he also did many important things in India. He introduced the railways, he introduced the telegraph, the first stamp was issued under him, he made Shimla the summer capital. Lord Dalhousie, very very important, and even doctrine of lapse was given by him, which proved to be one of the main causes for the revolt of 1857. Lord Curzon's time period is going to be he's going to be responsible for the partition of Bengal. This is going to be later. He's going to be in India around the year 1900. So question number 26, my answer is C, very important. Question number 27, the first one was related to modern India. Now this one is related to geography. The busiest oceanic trade route of the world is, which is the busiest oceanic trade route? Now we have our five oceans, Atlantic, Pacific, Indian, Arctic, Antarctic Ocean. These are our oceans. Now here answer for this question is Atlantic Ocean. And now I will explain to you why the Atlantic Ocean is the busiest oceanic trade route. Atlantic Ocean, why is it the busiest oceanic trade route? Now here we have the Atlantic Ocean. Okay, this is the place where Atlantic Ocean is there. Atlantic Ocean, now this side we have Europe, okay, and this side we have North America, the most developed and industrialized portions of the world. Now here I have put a picture of the map of Europe for you so that you can exactly see. We have France here, we have United Kingdom here, we have Germany here, then we have Poland here. Poland, United Kingdom, France, all these were the major powers which had colonized the world long ago, and the rest of the world was colonized under them. So we have the entire developed world here. Besides, if you come down a bit, you have here this entire Africa. Then we have, since we have the most developed world here, so a lot of trade is going to take place. So on either side we have developed countries, we have major fishing grounds here. So that is the reason that Atlantic Ocean has become the busiest oceanic trade route. And besides, the Suez Canal is also a part of the Atlantic Ocean. I will talk about the Suez Canal in the next slide. The Pacific Ocean is the largest ocean. Pacific largest and deepest, but not the busiest in terms of oceanic trade. Indian Ocean, we have Indian Ocean, only ocean to be named after the name of a country. And Arctic Ocean is our smallest ocean, but the biggest source for fresh water among all the oceans. Now see, I have also tried to show you the Suez Canal. Now Suez Canal is here. This is the Suez Canal. And prior to building of the Suez Canal, this was Europe. We had London here, and then different developed countries here. Now if one was to come from London to Mumbai and he wanted to come by a ship, this was the route he had to take all around, and this way he was supposed to come. But after the Suez Canal was built, this distance was shortened by many miles. The total length was 19,800 kilometers. But if one traveled this way, and then in Egypt we have the Suez Canal, if he traveled this way, then this distance was greatly cut down, and therefore this is a very very important canal in the world. If you talk about in terms of the achievement, if you talk about in terms of transport, very very important canal. And the Suez Canal, it has shortened the distance. It is the shortest distance between the east and the west, okay, and it has even changed the entire economy of Egypt. So Suez Canal, one of the major trade routes, is also a part of the Atlantic Ocean. That is the reason that the Atlantic Ocean is the busiest trade route. Busiest trade route because of numerous fishing grounds, the Dogger Bank is there, there are many natural gas fields because see, you have the whole of Africa here, then you also have the western portion of Asia where there are many petroleum deposits and gas fields. So very, very important. Here also you can see the Suez Canal, okay, the Suez Canal, here we have the Red Sea, here we have the Mediterranean Sea, and Suez Canal connects both these. Often you get a question as to Suez Canal connects which two waters. It connects the Mediterranean Sea. This is the Mediterranean region. Wonderful climate, plenty of, you will find plenty of grape orchards here. And then this side we have the Red Sea. This side we have the Red Sea. Question number 2, it was related to geography, which asked which is the busiest oceanic trade route. Question number 28, next one. When did the Soviet Union disintegrate into 15 independent republics? This is an important question from world history, but a very simple question. When did Soviet Union disintegrate into 15 independent? You must have heard of something called USSR, United Sovereign Socialist Republic, okay, USSR. Now, when did the Soviet Union disintegrate into 15 independent republics? This is my question. This is a prior map. This is the map which you can see here. This is a map of former Soviet Union. And this whole was considered as USSR. Now, we have Ukraine here. We have Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, Moldova, Georgia, numerous countries. And finally, it had broken down into 15 independent countries. When did this happen? This happened in 1991. This happened in the year 1991, and it happened one day after Christmas on 26th December 1991. What was the reason for Russia to break down this way? I will just explain to you in brief. Okay, I'll explain. Russia was a communist country. Russia was a communist country, and it was too huge an area which was put together. It was too huge an area which was put together, and generally it was a communist and a socialist country. In a socialist and a communist country, the government is responsible to provide all kind of facilities to the citizens. The private rights of the citizens, individual rights are not there. The individual rights are not there, and because of the economic policies of the government, the economic policies failed very badly to meet the demands of the state. The state was at that time caught up in a cold war with USA. There was a cold war between USA and USSR, and these two countries were forever competing. USSR and USA, they were caught up in a cold war, and USSR was in an arms race with USA, due to which this led to gradual economic decline, and it necessitated reforms to be taken. And besides, it was a very, very huge country which had been put together. It is always difficult when size is huge, administration is difficult. Besides, the arms race was going on, okay, and the policies of the government was failing to meet the needs of the people. And besides, people of different ethnic religions were put together. Only 50% of this population that lived here were Russians, others were not. Others were ethnically different, so they could not relate to the Russians. They could not relate to the Russians. And finally, in the year 1985, Mikhail Gorbachev came to power. When he came to power, he sensed that the economic problem that was there, and he tried to address these issues, and he gave the people the freedom of speech. And once he gave them the freedom of speech, all the frustration that was there in the people, that found an outlet. And then the people from different areas, they started demanding autonomy. And Estonia, this was the first region which demanded autonomy. And after Estonia demanded, then there were, once one country demanded, the others also started demanding. I wouldn't say the country demanded at that time, it wasn't a country. This region started demanding freedom. They wanted autonomy. Okay, after that, similarly, many nationalist movements started in Georgia, Ukraine, Central Asian Republic, etc. And people from other regions also started stating that they wanted to separate away from Russia. This is what they all started demanding. And finally, by the time it was 1992, then by that time there was popular demand. The Soviet Union ceased to exist, and in its place there was a Commonwealth of Independent Republics. But the situation now got out of control, and finally, I'll tell you just in short now, and finally by 26 December 1991, USSR no longer existed, and in its place came new 15 independent countries. And these are those independent countries. You have Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Georgia, Belarus. All these countries came into existence. Important date, one day after Christmas, 26 December 1991. Question number 29 related to geography, physical geography. Which one of the following is the second highest peak in the world? Options are Dholagiri, Kanchenjunga, K2 or Nanda Devi. What is the answer for question number 29? Question number 29, what is going to be the answer? Which of the following is the second highest peak in the world? Are you aware about which is the highest peak in the world? Yes, it is Mount Everest. And here, the second highest peak in the world is K2. The second highest peak in the world is K2. And here we have the names of the four highest peaks in the world. Mount Everest, then we have K2. Also known as Godwin Austen. We have Kanchenjunga. Kanchenjunga is in Sikkim, and these are the three highest peaks in the world. The highest peaks in the world are going to be in the Himalayas. Why so? Because these are the youngest fold mountains of the world. Youngest fold mountains. See, the younger a mountain is, the higher are going to be the peaks. Because in old mountains, what is going to happen? There is going to be erosion, rivers will have come down from the mountains, which will have cut down the mountains. So the height of old mountains is not going to be high, but the height of young mountains is going to be very high. So the highest peaks are in the Himalayas, which is the youngest fold mountains of the world. Highest is Mount Everest. Mount Everest, known as Sagar Matha in Nepal. It is the highest mountain peak in the world. Then we have K2. K2 in the Karakoram range of the Himalayas, and Kanchenjunga, which is in Sikkim. Question number 30. Who said patriotism is religion and religion is love for India? This is question number 30. Who said patriotism is religion and religion is love for India? The answer is Bankim Chandra Chatterjee. But here I would also like to say that some books mention it as Acharya Vinoba Bhave. So there is a little dispute about this answer. But since Acharya Vinoba Bhave is not there, thankfully our work has been made easier, and we will go with Bankim Chandra Chatterjee. Question number 31. Next question. The color of the eye depends upon the pigment present in. The color of the eye depends upon the pigment present in the cornea, the rods, the iris or the cones. Question number 31. The answer is going to be iris. The answer is going to be iris. Now for some questions, I have written an explanation under them. Let's read the explanation. The color of the eye depends upon the pigment present in. Eye colors depend on the amount of pigment or melanin found in the iris and how it is distributed. Light gray blue eyes contain much less pigment than external dark blue eyes. Melanin is also present in our skin. It is also present in our skin, and more the melanin, darker the skin. Similarly, now the more the it says light gray blue eyes contain much less pigment than extremely. Obviously in dark brown eyes there's going to be more. So that's the reason that they're darker in color. You have different colors for eyes, and what is responsible for the color given? It's melanin. And where is it found? It's found in the iris. Question number 31. Question number 32. Let's read question number 32. What does it say? Let's start. It says who is the author of the book To a Hunger Free World? Who is the author to the book A Hunger Free World? Let me read this for you now. To a Hunger Free World, the answer is M.S. Swaminathan. M.S. Swaminathan. Now, who is M.S. Swaminathan? Let us talk about that. Who is M.S. Swaminathan? M. S. Swaminathan is the man who is responsible for green revolution in India. He is responsible for green revolution in India. And what is the green revolution responsible for? The green revolution was responsible for abundance and abundance in food grains, especially wheat and rice. It is responsible for making India self-sufficient in food grains. Now let me tell you about M.S. Swaminathan. He is an Indian genetist and is renowned for his leading role in India's green revolution. It was a program in which high yielding varieties of wheat and rice seedlings were planted in the field of poor farmers, and he is known as Indian father of green revolution. In the world, it is Mr. Borlaug who is known as father of green revolution to the world. And it was because of his leadership and success in introducing and further developing high yielding varieties of wheat in India. And he started the vision as to rid the world of hunger and poverty. He wants everybody to have at least 2 square meals a day. In the 1960s, India had started the Green Revolution. After the Second World War, there was the need and the desire was felt that everybody should be given equal rights, country should become self-sufficient in food, grain, etc. And then finally, new technology was introduced in agriculture and high yielding varieties, HYV seeds. These were those plants which did not have much height but which had much more variety of grain. They were introduced and this was adopted in India in the around the year 1967-68. It was adopted in India. And who was responsible in India? It was M.S. Swaminathan. And this gentleman has written a book known as To a Hunger-Free World. Very important. Question number 32. Next is question number 33. Let us see what is question number 33. It asks, sea water can be purified by which process? We have distillation, evaporation, filtration and fractional distillation. These are my 4 options. Sea water can be purified by the process of distillation, evaporation, filtration and fractional distillation. It is not possible that the answer is evaporation, because what happens in evaporation? In evaporation, we evaporate the water will evaporate, nothing is going to be left behind. So how can seawater be purified? And basically, what is seawater? Seawater is water which has a higher salt content. It has a higher salt content. Now, what is distillation? This is distillation. What do we do? This is a very simple picture. Like, see, there's water in this vessel which has been put here. It's being heated from below. When it is going to be heated from below, then evaporation will start. If I do not cover it, it is simply evaporation. Okay? Vaporization will start. That is evaporation. But if I cover it up this way, okay? If I cover it up this way and I allow the vapor to come and cool down in this jar, you can say, then when it cools down in the jar from vapor, it is going to again become water. Now what evaporates? Only water is going to evaporate. The salts are going to be left behind. This is known as distillation. Even if you are boiling water on a gas, if you simply cover it up with a lid, after some time you will see tiny droplets of water on the inner side of the lid. So what is that? That is distilled water. That is distilled water. Okay, this is a simple process of distillation, and sea water can be purified by this process. Okay, then we have evaporation I just told you. Then we have filtration is a very different process. In filtration, what do? If there are substances in water or in the other liquid which have not dissolved, they are filtered out. And what is fractional distillation? Now, fractional distillation is the process of taking a chemical mixture and using heat to separate the various components in the mixture, because the different components in the mixture have different boiling points. It is used when we are interested in isolating one or more compounds present in a mixed sample containing as few as 2 or up to endless amount of compounds. Now, seawater simply had salt and water, but for petroleum, etc., for crude oil, okay, there are different substances having different boiling points. So at different boiling points, we collect different kind of substances. That is known as fractional distillation. Question number 33. What is the answer for question 33? Answer is A. 34. Which of the following is not a vaccine? BCG, anti-rabies, polio vaccine, Progesterone. My answer is progesterone. Progesterone is not a vaccine. BCG is there for TB. Okay. Anti-rabies. Rabies is a disease which we get from animals. Okay. From cats, dogs, etc. Polio vaccine. Very, very important discovery. Very, very important discovery to make the world free of polio. Then we have progesterone. Progesterone is one. What is progesterone? Progesterone is, it's a hormone in our body. Okay, it's a hormone in our body and it stimulates and regulates various functions. It is plays a very, very important role in pregnant women. So it is very important. It's a hormone, progesterone. Let me tell you in brief about BCG vaccine and anti-rabies vaccine also. The BCG vaccine, it is primarily used against tuberculosis. You could be given a question as to it prevents us against which disease. In countries where tuberculosis is a common one, a dose is recommended in healthy babies as close to the time of birth as possible. And what is rabies? Rabies is a contagious and fatal disease of dogs and other mammals. Mammals are those which give birth to live ones. They do not lay eggs, and the mother is going to feed the young one. Dogs are mammals. Cats are mammals. Okay, and it's a contagious and fatal viral disease of dogs and other mammals, and it is transmissible through the saliva to humans and causes madness and convulsions. So now there is a vaccine known as anti-rabies vaccine. This was question number 34. Now let's move on to question number 35. How many entities have been barred from trading in Bombay Stock Exchange? This is my question. SEBI. Okay, by SEBI. What is SEBI? SEBI is the Securities and Exchange Board of India. That is known as SEBI. And it is the regulator for securities market in India. What is a security? A security is simply a tradable financial asset. Shares of a company, that's a security. Now, the question is, how many entities have been barred from trading in Bombay Stock Exchange? An entity can be barred from trading in Bombay Stock Exchange if they violate any law, if they do not follow the rules and regulations which have been laid down. And recently, total of 59, the entities have been barred from trading in the Bombay Stock Exchange. The Securities and Exchange Board of India, it has passed an interim order against several wealthy investors, and they have been barred from trading in Bombay Stock Exchange. Why so? Because of for alleged manipulation of the stock exchange route for evading taxes. It's a crackdown against alleged market manipulators who look to evade taxes or convert black money into white money. This is the answer. This is the answer for question number 35. Question number 36. Next is question number 36. White phosphorus is always kept under. White phosphorus is always kept under. Question number 36. Question related to chemistry. White phosphorus, it is always going to be kept under water. And why do we need to put white phosphorus under water? Simple, because it catches air spontaneously when it comes in contact with air. It will get oxygen supply and it will immediately catch fire. So to cut down on the oxygen supply, because for burning oxygen is required, therefore we keep it under water. Besides some other features also, it's extremely poisonous, and 50 milligram constitutes an approximate fatal dose. White phosphorus should be kept under water as it is dangerously reactive in air, and it should not even be dealt empty-handedly. It should be dealt with forceps, and if you come in contact with it, it might severely even burn your skin. This is all about white phosphorus. So it is to be kept under water. Next is question number 37. Question number 37 related to physical geography. Related to physical geography of the world. Let's read question number 37. Which of the following volcanoes is situated in Mexico? You might be given the name of a volcano and they might ask you where is it located, but here you have been asked which of the following is situated in Mexico. Question number 37. First one is Colima, then Cimeru, then I have Pures and Etna. Etna is very, very famous. You must have heard of it. It's in Sicily, and Sicily is in Italy. So Etna is located in Italy. Then I have here, Etna is located in Italy. Then we have Sumeru. Sumeru is located in Indonesia. It's located in Indonesia. Where is Pures located? Pures is located in Colombia. Colombia. I am left with Colima. Yes, this is located in Mexico. It's located in Mexico. Question number 37. Question number 38. What is Eggmark? What is Eggmark? A-G-M-A-R-K. You must have heard of this word, but you must have never paid attention to it. So what does Eggmark stand for? Now, let me first read this here in brief for you, then I shall explain. This is the logo for Eggmark. Okay. The term Eggmark, if you break up the word, you will get one AG and you will get one word mark. AG is agriculture. AG is agriculture. I am not referring to silver here. In chemistry, yes, AG and AU, you must have read of them. Silver and gold. The term Eggmark was given by joining two words AG, which means agriculture, and mark for a certification mark. So Eggmark is simply a mark for agricultural goods. It's a mark for agricultural goods. Eggmark is a certification mark employed on agricultural products of India. You must have seen some mark like this also on products. There are different marks, like for example, I'll give you a very simple day-to-day life example. When you go in a restaurant and you see the menu card, things which are vegetarian, they will have a green dot and colored in green, or they'll have a small plant drawn near them. Things that are non-vegetarian, they will have a red mark near them. So what are all these? These are basically marks to identify. Similarly, this Eggmark is also, it's a certification, and it's a certification assuring for that product that it is of good quality. Eggmark is a certification mark which is employed on agricultural products in India. It assures that they conform to a set of standard approved by Directorate of Marketing and Inspection, which is an agency of the Government of India. The present Eggmark standards cover quality guidelines for 123 different commodities. So because they cover agricultural products, you will find this sign on cereals, essential oils, vegetable oils, fruits, vegetables, semi-processed products also. So this is Eggmark. It is going to be found on agricultural goods, certifying that they are of fine quality. Eggmark is a cooperative for egg production? No. It's a regulated agricultural market? No. It's a farmers cooperative? No. It's a quality guarantee stamp for commodities? Yes. It's a quality guarantee stamp for commodities. Question number 38. My answer is D. Question number 39. Which of the following countries has been digitized? Which of the following countries has digitized a collection of about 300 local Tamil literary works of around 50 years by a heritage group? Question number 39. This is my question. Current question. Answer is A. Singapore, and nothing much to explain here. Next is question number 40. Question number 40 related to plant nutrition. So what is it related to? It's related to bio. The question is related to bio. Let me do this for you. Okay. Which of these is a micronutrient for plants? There are two kinds of nutrients, micronutrients and macronutrients. Macronutrients are those nutrients required in a large quantity. Micronutrients are those which are required in a very small quantity. Now you have been given four options: carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, boron. Four options. Which of these is a micronutrient for plants? Micronutrients are nutrients which are required by organisms throughout life, but in small quantities to help in the functioning and performing of a range of physiological functions. Like for example, in human beings, for people, they include dietary trace minerals in amounts generally less than 100 milligrams per day, as opposed to macro minerals or macronutrients which are required in large quantities. Now in this one, which of these is a micronutrient for plants? Answer is boron. Boron is a micronutrient for plants, and now I shall explain to you, boron is essential for what in a plant? Why is it required by the plant? Plants must obtain the following nutrients from the growing medium. And what are those nutrients? Macronutrients are nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, sulfur, magnesium. Spelling of sulfur, S-U-L-P-H-U-R. Micronutrients, they are also known as trace minerals, are boron, chlorine, manganese, iron, zinc, copper, nickel, and all these. Now, what are the functions of boron? Boron has many functions in a plant. It affects the flowering of the plant, the fruiting, the pollen germination, cell division, and active salt absorption. In all these, boron has an important function to perform. That is why boron is a micronutrient required by the plant. Question number 40. Now let's move on to next one. Question 41. The substance that is added to make natural rubber strong and more bouncy is sulfur. If you want to make natural rubber more bouncy, it's sulfur. Question number 42 to be done here. The vitamin most readily destroyed by heat is? Which vitamin is most readily destroyed by heat? The answer is ascorbic acid. Ascorbic acid, also known in simple language as vitamin C. The vitamin most readily destroyed by heat is vitamin C. Vitamin C is known as ascorbic acid. It's a water-soluble vitamin found in fruits and vegetables. It includes oranges, strawberries, broccoli, tomatoes, and green peppers. Vitamin C is easily destroyed by excessive heat and water, as well as exposure to air. Sometimes, you know, in cooking, often it is true, you must have heard somebody say, don't overcook it, all the vitamins are going to finish. Don't they say so? It is said so because there are certain vitamins which are destroyed by heat. So much heating is not required by them. And even for such products, people prefer eating them raw. So ascorbic acid or vitamin C is one which is readily destroyed by heat. What are the sources of vitamin C? All citrus fruits, your lemons, oranges that you get, grapes, they all have vitamin C. Oranges, grapefruit, lime, lemon, they are excellent sources of vitamin C. Many non-citrus fruits also, such as papaya, strawberries, pineapple, kiwi, and raspberries, they are excellent sources of vitamin C. Question number 42. Next one, which of the following is a cold ocean current? What is a cold ocean current? Firstly, we need to understand what is an ocean current, and then we shall do what is a cold ocean current and what is a warm ocean current. What is an ocean current? This is going to be a continuous directed movement of oceanic water that flows in one of the Earth's oceans. So if the water of an ocean is flowing in a particular direction, and if the water is coming from a warm area, it is going to be known as a warm ocean current. Okay, now this is very important to understand the climate of the world. You need to even understand the flow of water in oceans. I'll cover all that in physical geography. All those students who are a part of the online coaching batch, this is there in physical geography. It's important. Now, for example, if we have a current coming from a warm area, generally the equatorial region is going to have warm currents because there is surplus supply of heat. The water on the top layer of the ocean is going to get heated, and heated water is lighter water, so it will flow try to flow away from that area. If it flows towards a cold area, then what is going to happen? It will raise the temperature of that area because it's a warm current. But similarly, if we have a current coming from a cold area, okay, if it comes into an area, then what is going to happen? It is going to further lower the temperature of that area. So very, very important. Okay, now what is a current? A current in simple language, is the flow of oceanic water from one area to another area. That is known as a current. And these currents can be generated due to various factors. The rotation of the earth is responsible. Winds can make water move. Temperature can also affect. Salinity differences, more the salt, denser the water is going to sink and it will become cold. Even gravitation of the moon is responsible. And there are two kinds of currents, cold and warm current. Cold current is that which is coming from a cold area, and it's going to be, when it goes to the new area, it is colder in comparison to the temperature of water there. And warm current is that which is warmer. Now let us take a look at this picture. In this picture, the different kinds of currents are there. Like, for example, we have this current, Uglass current, we have Brazilian, Venezuela, South Equatorial, Equatorial counter. We have different kinds of currents that are there in the world's oceanic waters. They have been shown here in this picture. This is a list of all the currents. You often get a question on oceanic currents. Like for example, we have the Alaska current. Alaska current, it is in the North Pacific region and it's a warm current. We have the Brazilian current, it's in the South Atlantic, it's a warm current. California current in the North Pacific and cool current. You can be given a question as to four options will be there. Which of the following is a cold current? Which of the following is a warm current? You can be given a question like that. Please remember that wherever a cold and a warm current is going to meet, that is going to be an important fishing ground in the world. Because what is going to happen when a cold and a warm current is going to meet, the colder water is going to go to under the warmer water, because colder water is heavier, it's denser, it's going to sink, and the warmer water is going to come on the top. This will cause churning of the water, which will bring in the phytoplanktons on the top, which is food for fish. And in such areas where cold and warm current are going to meet, you are going to find them as excellent fishing grounds in the world. Dogger Bank is an example of this. So this is a very important slide. Here just learn which are the cold currents, which are the warm currents, etc. You could even be asked a question as to which current is found in Japan. It's the Kuroshia current. It's the Kuroshia current. So just learn them. It's important. Question. The next question to be done is question number 45 related to art and culture in India. Which of the following pairs is incorrect? Pannalal Ghosh and flute, Guru Gopi Krishna and Kathak, Nikhil Banerjee and Santur, Nandalal Bose and painting. These are my four options. My incorrect answer is this one. C. Nikhil Banerjee Santur. Nikhil Ranjan Banerjee, he is related to the sitar. He passed away in the year 1986. Nikhil Ranjan Banerjee, he was an eminent Indian classical artist of the Mihar Gharana, along with Pandit Ravi Shankar and Ustad Vilayat Khan. So learn these two also, that Pandit Ravi Shankar is also associated to sitar and Ustad Vilayat Khan also. He emerged as one of the leading exponents of the sitar, and he is regarded as a legend in Indian classical music. And he's a receiver of the Padma Bhushan also. And he was the youngest sitarist to be employed by All India Radio. At the age of 9 years, he had begun to play on the All India Radio. Question number 45. Question number 46. Which breed of the following buffalo breeds is found in southwestern part of Gujarat? This is my question. I have Murra, I have Bhadwari, I have Surti and I have Toda. These are my four options. My answer is Surti. The Surti is a breed of water buffalo which is found in Gujarat between the Mahi and Sabarmati river. And what is unique about this buffalo is that it has got a unique straight back. The Surti buffalo is of medium size and docile temperament. Then we have Murra buffalo. This buffalo is known for its quantity of milk. It gives a lot of milk, and recently even a world record was created by a buffalo known Rani, which is from Punjab, and a world record was created in the year 2016 itself. The Murra breed, it's a water buffalo. It's a breed of domestic water buffalo kept for dairying production, and it is found in Rohtak, Jind, Hisar, Jhajjar, Fatehabad, Gurgaon and Union Territory of Delhi. So it's basically found in Haryana and Punjab. And in Brazil, this breed of buffalo is even used for production of meat and also milk. Murra. Now let me tell you a little bit about Bhadwari and Toad breeds also. The Bhadwari is a breed of water buffalo from Uttar Pradesh, India, that is kept for milk production. It is found in Agra and Itawa districts, and it is also found in MP. Bhadwari buffaloes are specifically, now the specific feature about this buffalo is, like for example, I told you about Murra, they give a lot of milk. The quantity of milk is huge. In Bhadwari, the milk has high content of buttermilk. It is specifically renowned for the high content of buttermilk fat found in their milk. So if you want to have a buffalo for ghee, then this is the buffalo to be had, which ranges from 6% to as high as 12.5%. and the relative high percentage of buttermilk present in their milk is due to the Bhadwari's efficiency in converting animal feed into butter fat. Finally, the toad breed is found with the toads of Nilgiris, which is a tribe, and since this tribe has domesticated this buffalo, that is the region it is named as toad. They have huge horns. They predominate, coat colors are fawn and ash gray. These buffaloes are quite distinct from other breeds and are indigenous to Nilgiri Hills. Important, and they are gregarious by nature. Buffaloes very, very important for milk production in the world, not just in India. And about 65% of the milk supplied in India comes from buffaloes. After that, it is from the cows. Question number 47, the next one to be done here. The World Bank normally gives, short-term loans, medium-term loans, long-term loans, or medium and long-term loans. These are my four options. Now, what is the World Bank? It's an international financial institution and it provides loans to developing countries for capital programs. There are two institutions under it, the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development and International Development Association. And the World Bank is a component of World Bank Group, which is a part of the United Nations system. I really liked the bank's official goal, and the bank's official goal is reduction of poverty. This is the goal, and the World Bank normally gives what kind of loans? It gives medium term loans. It gives medium term loans. B is my answer for question 47. Question number 48, let us do this. Which of the following standing committees of parliament has no MP from Rajya Sabha? Public Accounts Committee, Estimates Committee, Committee on Public Undertakings, Committee of Government Assurances. Four options. My answer is Estimates Committee. But in the next slide, I will explain to you what exactly is a committee, what kinds of committees are there, and then what exactly is an Estimates Committee. So let's move on to that. What is a committee? Now, the work of the parliament cannot be done all by itself. The work done by parliament in modern times is not only varied in nature but even in volume, and besides, the work has to be done in limited time also. Therefore, many committees are formed and work is assigned to them. The parliament cannot therefore give close consideration to all legislative and other matters that come before it. A lot of work of business is therefore transacted by what is called parliamentary committees. And these parliamentary committees are known as ad hoc and standing committees. Two kinds of committees are there, ad hoc and standing. Ad hoc committees are those which are appointed for a specific purpose. They are appointed for a specific purpose, and once that job is done, even the committee ceases to function. But it is not so in the case of standing committees. Parliamentary committees, there are two types, ad hoc committees and standing committees. Ad hoc committees are appointed for a specific purpose and they cease to exist when they finish the task which is assigned to them. They'll give their report and then it's bye-bye. But apart from ad hoc committees, each House of Parliament has standing committees also, known as Business Advisory Committee, Committee on Petitions, Committee of Privileges, Rules Committee, etc. And these will not cease to function. They will be there. Then we have the Estimates Committee. Let's come back to the Estimates Committee. What was the Estimates Committee about which the question was there? The Estimates Committee does not have a single member from Rajya Sabha, only members from the Lok Sabha. The Estimates Committee, it came into existence first time in the year 1950. It's a parliamentary committee which has 30 members, which elected every year by the Lok Sabha from among its members. And then the functions of the Estimates Committee are that they will give a rough estimate as to how much money is to be allocated to various departments of the government. They have to report what economies, improvement in organization, efficiency or administration reform consistent with the policy underlying the estimates may be affected. They suggest alternative policies in order to bring efficiency and economy in administration. They examine whether the money is well laid out within the limits of the policy implied by the estimates. So all these are the functions of the estimate committee. There's going to be a person who's going to head the committee. And this person, he should not be a minister. If only a non-minister can become the head of such committee, this is the Estimates Committee. Question number 48. Let's move on to question number 49. The sky appears blue because, this is a question related to science. You have plenty of questions on everyday natural phenomena. You can get questions as to why does the sun appear red when it is setting, or why does the sun appear larger at sunrise and larger at sunset. These kind of questions are asked. Here the question is, the sky appears blue because all colors interfere to produce blue. In white light, the blue component dominates. The atmosphere scatters blue color more than the others, and it is actually blue. These are my four options. Question number 49. This is the answer. This is the answer. Now, actually, the light from the sun, it appears to a layman to be white, or you can even say colorless. But actually, when you scatter that light through a prism, or when you see a rainbow, you will realize that it has seven colors with G-O-R. V-I-V-I-B-G-Y-O-R. It's violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange and red. You must have heard of this word when you were in school. So light from sun appears white, but it actually consists of many different colors, and we can see these different colors of light in a rainbow or when white light passes through a prism. The function of the prism is to scatter the light. Now, as the white light passes from sun, it travels through the earth's atmosphere, and in the atmosphere there are plenty of dust particles, there are plenty of aerosols. It collides with these particles in the air, and then it is scattered in different directions, and the light has varying different wavelengths. The different colors of varying wavelength of light are scattered by these collisions. Blue light has shorter wavelength, and this is going to be scattered more than red light. So when the sun is higher in the sky, blue light is scattered in all directions as sunlight passes through the atmosphere, and we see the sky as blue. But in the case of sunset, etc., it is the blue light has been scattered too much and red light dominates. But it's a different case when the sun is close to the horizon at sunset or sunrise. Sunlight from the sun, low sun, has to pass much more atmosphere before it reaches your eyes, meaning most of the blue light has already been scattered, leaving just red. And that is the reason that at sunset we get to see the red light. So for this question, what is my answer? The answer for question number 49 is C. The atmosphere scatters blue color more than the others. So that was the answer. Now let's move on to question number 50, a question from current events. Who has been appointed as the new Lieutenant Governor General of Puducherry? It is Kiran Bedi. Kiran Bedi, she had joined the BJP, and then she had even contested. She was the chief ministerial candidate in the elections for Delhi. And recently, she has been appointed as the Lieutenant Governor for Puducherry. That was the last question to be done. I wish you all the very, very best, and